Thank you for hearing me on this budget consultation. My name is Tom Hooper, and I'm a historian of the 1981 Toronto bathhouse raids. I'm also a member of the No Pride in Policing Coalition. Next week is the 40th anniversary of the February 5th, 1981 bathhouse raids, where 306 gay men were arrested in one night in a coordinated police raid by more than 200 officers. This was the result of a six-month undercover investigation in Toronto's gay bathhouses in what police called Operation Soap. Using these funds from the city's budget, police purchased entry into our community's baths, removed their clothes, put on towels, and strolled through the halls and steam rooms looking for gay sex, or what in legal criminal code terms is known as acts of indecency in a common body house. With this in-strip of 1970s Yonge Street cleaned up, the police needed a new enemy to justify their budget. As it turns out, when police have money, they use it to target marginalized communities. It's in this context that 200 officers ransacked four gay bathhouses, destroying property and terrifying the individuals they placed under arrest. The community responded to this police violence with a massive protest in the streets. Thousands of people marched, including one of the speakers at the protest, Lamona Johnson. Her husband, Albert Johnson, was murdered by police in 1979. The bath raids highlighted the connections between police violence against queers and against Black people. In the decades after police killed Albert Johnson, we have seen numerous examples of violent interactions between police and Black, Indigenous, and people of color. Now, at the time, City Council expressed its outrage at the bath raids. But when we look at the historical records, we see council made similar pleas we hear today. We need more training. We need more diversity. We need more community liaison officers. We need more reform. And among the favorite of elected officials, we need an official inquiry. The 1981 Bruner Report was the city's response to the bath raids. The report and its recommendations sat on a shelf and was ignored for more than a decade. Among Bruner's recommendations was a moratorium on police raids against gay men in parks. In 2016, only months after the police's so-called apology for the bath raids, police were yet again going undercover behind the bushes to entrap men seeking harmless moonlight encounters. Now, I understand we're about to receive another official inquiry, which I'm sure will have excellent recommendations that the police can spend 40 years ignoring. In 1981, our community highlighted the harm police violence was causing to the community. Several gay men had gone missing, and their murders were not taken seriously by police. And here we are 40 years later, facing similar problems. We keep hearing similar answers. In the recent case of a serial killer in the village, we now know that men, several from the South Asian community, were murdered. We have witnessed the unsolved murders of sex workers and trans women, including Alora Wells. The institution of policing is incapable of providing our communities with safety and crisis response. Now, Operation Soap, Project Marie, and police violence more broadly requires money. It's time to move on from this past and imagine a future where these funds could be reallocated away from police violence and into new community-led and community-based anti-violence, harm reduction, and crisis response programs. 50% of the police budget should be reallocated to this immediately. As a historian, I understand that our institutions may seem like they're permanent and irreplaceable, but they're not. The institution of policing as we know it today emerged from the violence of colonialism against Indigenous peoples and the enforcement of slavery codes. We have seen this legacy play out in the present. We need to ask ourselves if this institution belongs going forward in the 21st century.